Hello, my name is André Bauer, I'm from the University of Würzburg, and today I would like to introduce Libra, our benchmark for time series forecasting methods. We humans are fascinated by forecasting. Since thousands of years we try to foresee upcoming events to get any advantage. So in the early stage of humankind, we were observing birds, or in the ancient Greek, we were going to Delphi to get predictions from the oracle. And about 50 years ago, time series analysis and forecasting arose. And since then, it's an active research topic with applications in many domains. And as there are so many domains, there are also a lot of different methods performing differently good. So one may ask, is there one method that performs best? Unfortunately, this possibility is denied by no-free-lunch theorem. This says there is no globally best method. Here's an example from the electricity sector, and black are the actual data, and red and blue are forecasts from different methods. And we can see here that clearly red is the best method. Here's a time series from the airline sector with the same color scheme, and we see that red and blue are quite good, but blue is a better method. So each method has its benefits and drawbacks depending on the specific use case. So now how to choose which my method for a certain application. We can either apply trial and error or we can ask an expert. However, both practices are prone to error and are time consuming. In order to avoid trial and error for selecting best methods, we were looking in how academia is solving this problem. So we surveyed more than 100 papers, and the inclusion criteria was the paper have to be cited at least 8.5 per year, that is a kind of impact factor to the community. It has to be published within the last 40 years, and of course it needed an evaluation section. We were interested in how many measures were used, how many methods were compared, and how many time series were considered. Here is the result of our survey, and we can see that most papers consider less than 4 measures, less than 8 methods, and less than 9 time series. And moreover, none of these papers considered the time to result, or they gave no information about the time to result. And if we look closely at this graph, we see that there are some papers that have a lot of time series, ranging about thousands of time series. These papers used forecasting competitions like the M or NN competitions, but a short spoiler, I will speak later about them. They have a high homogeneity within their time series, so they are not that good representable. So to conclude our survey, we can say that these papers provide no basis to guide the choice of an abbreviative forecasting method. So our idea was to create a forecasting benchmark, and therefore we developed Libra, and Libra supported an automated ranking and evaluation of forecasting methods. It has diverse scenarios. We have 400 time series that are quite inhomogeneous. We have several forecasting accuracy measures. We consider the time to result. And here is how Libra works. We have a developer who is implementing a forecasting method that is then deployed at Libra. And when Libra is performing with this forecasting method for each time series a forecast and calculates the measures, and in the end a report is created and sent to a user. Moreover, Libra is open source. That means we have a source code available at GitHub, and we created also a code ocean capsule for rerunning our results that we presented later. While benchmarking a certain method, the user can choose between 3 different evaluation types. The first one is one step ahead, That means time series is passed to the forecaster method, and when the forecaster method is forecasting the next point, we have multi-step ahead forecast. Here, a method is forecasting several points at once. It's also depicted here, the blue is depict the time series, and the green is the forecast. And the third possibility is rolling origin forecast. Here, the forecast method gets an increasing part of the time series, and for each part, the forecast is performed. In the end, we have for each time series several forecasts, and that allows us to compute the variability of a forecast method or stability. Besides the evaluation type, the user can also choose between four different domains. The first one is from the economic sector, the second one from finance, the third from human access on computing systems, and the third one is from nature and demographics. We gathered our time series from different publicly available data sources. Here are the distribution, and here are also the distribution of frequency and length within each application domain. As I mentioned before, there are also different forecasting competitions like the M competition, NN competition, and tourism competition. And we were curious about how our dataset in Libra differs from these datasets. And therefore, we investigate the distribution of the seasonality within each dataset, the distribution of the length within each dataset, and we investigate how heterogeneous each dataset is. If you look at the seasonality distribution, we see that our dataset has the longest or widest range of seasonality. Please note that the y-axis is depicted in log scale. And we see that the NN3 and NN5 competition has only time series with a fixed seasonality. And if you look at the length, we see also that our dataset has the widest range. And here again, the y-axis is depicted in log scale, and for example, the NN5 competition has also only time series with a certain length. In order to calculate how heterogeneous two time series are, we use the distance between the time series, and if we would use the geometric distance, it would be difficult because the time series have different lengths, and therefore we calculate the distance between two time series based on their characteristics. And for characteristics, we use, for example, the strength of the trend component, stability, the spectral entropy, and so on. And the distance between two time series based on their characteristics is defined as shown here. And we perform for each pair of time series within the dataset this calculation. In the end, we take the average, and so we get how heterogeneous the time series are. And here is a picture showing the characteristic distribution within each data set. And if you look about the heterogeneity, we see that our data set again exhibits the widest range, or in other words, has a higher diversity between time series. After introducing our benchmark Libra, we now want to benchmark forecasting methods. Our forecasting methods of interest can be divided into two groups. Classical methods, here we look at ETS, SRema, S-naive, T-BUDS, and Feather. And the other group is regression-based machine learning methods. Here we look at GPyTorch, NNDATAR, Random Forest, SVR, and XGBoost. Libra implements the following measures. We have two accuracy-based measures. One is based on the symmetrical mean absolute percentage error called SMAP, and the other one is based on a mean absolute scale error called MACE. Then we have two measures that capture the relative number of forecast values that under or overestimate the actual values. Two measures that reflect the mean percentage error during under or overestimating the actual values. And we also record the time to result, but we normalize it by the time of S naive. Libra offers four different use cases. Here we look as an example at the economic use case. And at first we will look at the classical methods. The best values are highlighted in bold and the lower the better. And we see that ETS is the most accurate method for the error based on the SMAP. And if you look at the maze, we see that ARIMA is the most accurate method in terms of time to result. S-naive has the lowest value, and for example, ARIMA, that is the most accurate method based on maze, is 7,000 times slower than S-naive. If you now look at the regression-based methods, we see that they are faster than the classical methods, but they are less accurate. So for example, the most accurate method based on the SMAP is NTAR, and it is way worse than all other classical methods. To summarize our results across all four use cases, this table shows the average values among these use cases and shows the five best forecasting methods. Among these five forecasting methods, there are four classical forecasting methods and only one regression-based method. And our key takeaways are that the machine learning methods have a higher forecast error than the classical methods. The machine learning methods are faster than the classical methods. S-ARIMA is on average the most accurate method. It has the lowest SMAP and the lowest maze, but it's almost 1 million times lower than S-naive. XGBoost is the most accurate machine learning method and is only 6.73 times slower than S-naive. And finally, S-naive is an on average the third best method, but it exhibits a high forecast error for non-seasonal time series. Now I'm going to conclude the presentation about our forecasting benchmark called Libra. So first of all, forecasting is an important task for many decision-making fields. And therefore, the choice of the most accurate method is a crucial challenge. And one may ask, is there one forecast method that is best for all use cases? Unfortunately, the answer is no, because the no-free lunch theorem denies this possibility because there is no globally best forecast method for all scenarios. So we were looking at the academia, how they solve this problem, but we found out that the academia or the research papers are not helpful for choosing the best forecast method, and therefore we had the idea to propose Libra, our benchmark for time series forecasting methods. And Libra comprises four use cases. Each of these use cases has 100 time series. We implement several forecast accuracy measures and also the time to result, because the time to result is lacking also in academia and is also an important parameter for choosing the right method. We measured in this paper 10 reference methods and report the results. And we made Libra open source. So the source code of Libra can be found at GitHub. And we also created a reproducible CodeOcean capsule to rerun our experiments. So I'm at the end of the presentation. Thank you for your attention. And now I'm going to show the references.